Okay, I think we're ready to get started. Probably be a few more joining as it goes along, but welcome everyone. Thank you very much for attending this latest installment of our webinar series, The Lifecycle of a Smart Idea. My name is Neil Henderson, and I'm based out of Toronto, Canada, where we've just come out of lockdown, thank goodness, and I'll be moderating the webinar today. Just to start, a couple of housekeeping notes. The first one is that we will be recording the webinar today, and it should be available on our website within a few days. The second one is, if you do have questions, we'll be using the Q&A feature in Zoom. It's a button located at the bottom of your screen. So just enter any questions there, and we'll try and deal with them during the webinar. If we don't get to any questions, there are breakout rooms at the end of the webinar where you can ask your question and follow up with any of the panelists. So to get going, today's webinar is part one of a three-part series focused on scaling and commercialization. Whether you're going from small to medium or medium to large, we will provide you with information you can use to commercialize IP strategically throughout the scaling process as you grow. We have a great panel from around the world, great coverage geographically, and they are all very experienced in both legal and business aspects of commercialization agreements and its implications for IP and the broader business world. So starting off, we have Paul Armitage, who's based out of Vancouver, Canada. Paul is a go-to person for technology commercialization. He has over 20 years of experience in technology commercial transactions and is a great guy as well. We've got Matilda Davidson, is based out of London, UK. Matilda advises across the spectrum of transactional intellectual property matters with a focus on life sciences and R&D partnering deals. We also have Vivian Demont, who's based out of Guangzhou, China. He's worked for over 15 years in China and is very well versed in the intricacies of Chinese law on foreign investment, M&A, technology transactions, and employment law. So to get us started, we'll have a brief polling question to see what's on your mind with regard to scaling and commercialization. So please take a second and put in your vote with regard to growing and protecting IP, international expansion, finding partners, funding investment M&A. These are all pretty important things as you're growing and scaling your business, but clearly people are mostly interested in growing and protecting your IP with 60%. That's great. Thank you everyone for your feedback. And growing and protecting your IP is what this is all about. So you're in the right place. So just to set the framework, we're looking at this as whatever stage you're at in terms of your growth, you're gonna have challenges. Scaling up IP usually just means things like adding to your patent portfolio, adding to your trademark portfolio, whether it's in terms of numbers or in terms of the geographic scope. We can obviously help with all those things, but today we wanted to focus on the various commercial agreements that can also help you scale and grow your business using your IP, whether it's distributor agreements, manufacturing agreements, licensing agreements. These can all be used strategically to help you grow. And as you know, commercial agreements, they always require some local understanding of the key elements of IP and business in some of those key jurisdictions. And we've got people here to talk about all those key jurisdictions. So in this webinar, you will learn about the key elements of commercial agreements with a particular focus on IP licensing agreements. We will also cover how to be ready to bring in investment money or use M&A for growth and commercialization. So we are going to begin with commercial agreements and some of the clauses that you need to consider for making a successful business transaction. I'll turn it over to Paul to begin the discussion. Paul, please.
Yes, well, thank you, Neil. So we're gonna start by looking at some powerful, but sometimes overlooked clauses that you can include in your commercial agreements to really take the IP clauses in those agreements to the next level. And here we could be talking about a license agreement, a distribution agreement, joint venture, collaboration, strategic alliance, really whatever the case may be. So the first topic we're going to look at is exclusivity. Now, exclusivity is a topic that should be covered in any agreement that's dealing with intellectual property. And there are really four variations on exclusivity. First off, there is the true exclusive license. In this scenario, the licensor licenses all the IP rights exclusively to a single licensee. And that includes as against the licensor itself. So in other words, the licensor can no longer practice the IP itself, and there's only a single licensee that's permitted to use the IP. The second variation on exclusivity is the converse, which is of course a non-exclusive license. Under a non-exclusive license, not only does the licensor retain the right to continue to practice the IP itself, but it can also create multiple licensees, relicensing the same IP to multiple companies. The third type of exclusivity is what's commonly called a sole license. Under a sole license, once again, the licensor retains the rights to practice the IP itself, but it agrees to only create a single licensee. And then finally, there's what's called retained rights. So in the context of an exclusive license, even though the licensor grants an exclusive license to the licensee, the licensor nonetheless retains certain rights itself. For example, to use the same IP for a different product in a different field or application or a different territory.
So moving on. With exclusive licenses, the big part is that you can ask for more money up front or for a higher royalty. So exclusivity can be a very good bargaining chip.
Yes, yeah. So exclusivity typically is one of the most valuable assets that a licensor of intellectual property has. So moving on from exclusivity, we move to non-competition. So non-competition is similar but different to exclusivity, because what non-competition refers to is including clauses in your agreement that would prevent your licensor from competing against your products in the marketplace. So it's potentially a very powerful clause to include in your agreements. Now, whenever you're looking at including a non-competition clause in an agreement, however, one needs to be aware of the rules around enforceability of these types of clauses, because in many jurisdictions, there could be enforceability issues as a matter of law around non-competition clauses. For example, in many jurisdictions, generally speaking, in order to be enforceable, a non-competition clause has to be reasonable as to scope and territory. So the next topic we're going to look at are improvements. And so improvements, those refer to improvements that are made to the licensed intellectual property after the date of the initial license. And these can be made by either the licensor or by the licensee. And it's useful to look at improvements in the context of an agreement from the perspective of both of those parties. So first off, if you are the licensee of intellectual property, you may wish to ensure that all the future improvements of your licensor are automatically included under your agreement. Otherwise, you may find yourself in the uncomfortable position a few years down the road of having to go back to your licensor to get new license rights to their future improvements, and of course, pay more money for that at that time. If you happen to be the licensor in the relationship, you may have an interest in obtaining access to the improvements that your licensees make. And you may want this access to be either ongoing during the term of the agreement or when the agreement is over. So when the agreement terminates or expires, you may wish to get back from the licensee what improvements the licensee may have made to the licensed technology during the term of the agreement. Now, the mechanism that would occur is what's called a grant back clause. And under a grant back clause, the improvements of the licensee are transferred either by way of an assignment or by a license back to the licensor. However, one needs to be aware of when dealing with grant backs that local law requirements or restrictions may apply that affect the enforceability of grant back clauses. So recently we were acting for a Canadian company that was licensing technology into China, and there we involved our Guangzhou office to help us navigate through the Chinese law of grant backs. And Vivian is going to speak to that now.
Thanks, Paul. And yes, what you've explained on technology improvements, this is particularly important in some jurisdictions like China, where you have, you know, many factories developing their own technologies. And these factories might very well become competitors of their clients at some point. So to illustrate what has just been said by Paul, let's take the example of, like, say, a Canadian purchaser of goods to be manufactured by a supplier in China under OEM arrangement. And then this purchaser or licensor shares its own technology and equipment to the supplier in China. Well, during the manufacturing process of the goods, if the supplier develops a technology improvement which is patentable in China, that party would be considered the inventor of the improvement. And so will normally own all the IP rights on it, despite the fact that the supplier has developed the technology improvement thanks to its client's technology in the first hand, you see. So the key takeaway here is not that it's not because the technology improvement has been made on your technology that you would automatically own it. In fact, it's actually to the contrary. So now in China, the law has changed just a few years ago, and it's possible, actually highly recommended, to specify in your written contract that any technology improvements made by the licensee shall be owned by the licensor. You really need to write that down on the contract, provided that there's a reasonable compensation to be paid to the licensee. And Chinese law would require that this reasonable compensation be paid in addition to the normal purchase price of the goods that the licensor would pay to the supplier. I understand that there are also some similar rules in the UK and the rest of Europe. Matilda, did you want to touch upon it?
Yes, thanks, Vivian. That's really interesting to hear on China. In the UK, we don't have that specific requirement that you mentioned for reasonable compensation. But the overall position on ownership of improvements is very similar to the one you've outlined in China. Unfortunately, you know, as you flagged up, with IP, just because you've paid for something or it's based on your core technology, it doesn't necessarily mean that you own it. So if the agreement in question is silent, then under English law, ownership will typically follow inventorship and the party creating the improvement will own it. And what that means, of course, is that you do need to think about this upfront and deal with improvements specifically in the contract to avoid issues down the line. Plus, as Paul and Vivian have said, you need to be alive to local law considerations such as competition issues that may affect what you can and can't do.
Yes, great. So the next topic we're going to look at are diligence efforts of the licensee. So here, if you are the licensor, you may have a concern that after licensing your intellectual property to the licensee, the licensee just sits on it and doesn't actually wind up taking a product to market. So this is sometimes called shelving of IP, or in the UK, it's called a discontinuance of IP. So to avoid shelving or discontinuance, if you are the licensor, you usually want to include in your contract various milestone events that need to be achieved by the licensee, such as raise a certain amount of money, make a regulatory filing for a product, bring a product to market, and then attach timelines to each of those events. So for example, bring a product to market within 3 years after signing the agreement. And then as the licensor, you want to make sure that there are consequences attached to the failure by the licensee to miss those time limits. For example, a common consequence that's included is the conversion of an exclusive license to a non-exclusive license. Now, this may seem like a reasonably fair way to deal with a diligence failure by a licensee, because it doesn't totally take their rights away. It just allows the licensor to appoint someone else who may have better success in the marketplace. However, there is some potential downside to that mechanism from the perspective of the licensor, because if you are the licensor, as you alluded to earlier, exclusivity is one of your most valuable assets and one of your strongest chips you can play in the world of IP. So if you've already given, if you convert your exclusive licensee to a non-exclusive licensee, that means you can't give anyone else a purely exclusive license, and therefore that may affect the value of your other deal that you may want to do. So as an alternative to conversion, an option, of course, is termination. So if the diligence timeline is missed, the licensor can then terminate the license, take back the IP, and find a new partner. Of course, if you are the licensee, you're going to have a very different perspective on things. And your concern will be that you will have invested all this time and money in developing the intellectual property, and then suddenly you have the rug pulled up from underneath you due to failure to meet a relatively arbitrary timeline over which you may not have full control. So the question, of course, is, well, how do you square this circle? For the interests of the licensor in having definite time limits in the agreement, and the interest of the licensee in having a more flexible arrangement, which is usually couched in terms of using commercially reasonable efforts, or CRE, to achieve product development and commercialization. So there are various ways this can be done. And no doubt this would be a subject of negotiation between the parties. One approach is to allow for an opportunity for a licensee, in the case of a missed timeline, to have the opportunity to produce a new development and commercialization plan, create a new time limit, and really give them the opportunity to cure the initial breach. Another approach is to mix and match timelines with commercially reasonable efforts. And so the timelines could be attached to events over which the licensee has control. So for example, raise $5 million within 18 months of signing the agreement, but commercially reasonable efforts could be used for more future events over which the licensee may have less control over the definite timing, such as the timing for obtaining a regulatory approval for a product, because of course the exact timing of that will be dependent on the regulatory process itself.
I've also seen where there's a sort of a cure provision where basically the licensee can just pay a certain amount of money to cure that lack of diligence, at least for a short time. So there's lots of negotiable options here.
Yes, yeah. Yeah, it's whatever you can, your minds can come up with to sort of, so to speak, square that circle and make both parties comfortable with the deal. So the next set of clauses we're going to look at are rights of first refusal or rights of first negotiation. So the basic theory with these clauses, of course, is that if you are in business with a company that had a good idea once, a good piece of technology for you on one occasion, there's a very good chance that that company will have something that's useful for you as well in the future. And so what the rights of first refusal and rights of first negotiations do is they give you the right of first choice over new offerings by your licensor. And that could be a new product, it could be entering a new territory, it could be a new application or field of use of the existing technology. Now, the essential difference between a right of first refusal and a right of first negotiation is that the former allows the holder of the right to match a specific deal, whereas in a right of first negotiation, once the trigger occurs, so for example, the licensor makes the decision to launch a new product, the licensee would then have the right to negotiate what the terms of the licensee acquiring rights to that product might be. Now, bear in mind, when we're talking about rights of refusal and rights of first negotiation is having an understanding going into it, what really are the rights you are acquiring under those clauses? And Matilda will speak about that.
Yeah, well, thanks, Paul. I mean, I think one of the big issues here, which you and I have discussed in the past, is around the enforceability question. A right of first refusal or right of first negotiation can seem, a very neat way of future-proofing your agreements, but there can be challenges about just how enforceable they are in practice. In particular, when I see these types of provisions drafted out in an English law context, they don't really typically amount to much more than an agreement to agree, which is not enforceable under English law. And of course, in your agreement, you can put in some useful architecture around them as to how the process will work. But I would be cautious, particularly from an English law perspective, about over-relying on them. As in reality, the most you can really hope to achieve is a right to participate in any future partnering or sale discussions. It's not a 100% guaranteed outcome.
Right. Okay, so the next clause we're going to look at is what's called a change of control provision. So what this refers to is, well, what is the effect on an existing agreement if one of the parties to the agreement, could be the licensor, could be the licensee, undergoes a change of control? So in other words, they sell their company and new owners are brought in. So if a change of control occurs, what effect, if any, should that have on the contract between the parties? So if you are the licensor of intellectual property, an interesting clause that is occasionally used is to give the licensor some share of the upside of that change of control by your licensee. This could be in the form of more consideration, a payment of some sort, or perhaps even a share of the proceeds from that sale. The basic logic to that clause, of course, is that it is the licensor's valuable intellectual property in the first place that allowed the licensee to sell its company for a good price, and therefore the licensor should share some part of that upside. Now, of course, there are many issues with this clause and many other aspects of change of control clauses that need to be thought about when writing these clauses into your agreements. And both Vivian and Matilda are going to talk about some of the ins and outs of these clauses.
Yes, thanks, Paul. For M&A transactions, this kind of clause can be quite tricky, if not a deal breaker sometimes, when you're interested in acquiring a company which has technologies that are interest for you, but some of these technologies actually under license agreement by a third party. What we see in practice is that some of these license agreements with a change of control clause would then, the license agreement would be automatically terminated in case of sale of the company. Or sometimes the transfer of the license agreement with the technology that you're interested in, transfer would be subject to prior approval by the licensor, the third party. So, this kind of clause usually it's really a powerful tool for the licensors in order to prevent that their licensees be sold to their competitors, for example.
Yes, thanks, Vivian. And actually, for exactly the reasons you've outlined, because they're so powerful in favor of licensors, these clauses can be pretty tricky to negotiate, I would say. I've seen some very, very firm pushback from licensees because they can be such a significant limitation. For example, on a founder's options for exit, and they can also put off potential investors as well. So it's a proceed with caution, I would say.
Yeah, that's definitely true. You want to maintain as much control as you can, whichever side you're on. So next up, we're going to move into some further specifics for different types of agreements. And Vivian is going to lead us on this discussion. Thanks, Vivian.
I'm happy to do it. Thanks, Neil. So let's start with the standard non-disclosure agreement, NDA. This is something that usually in practice companies will easily think of. And will get signed before sharing any confidential information, IP or technical know-how with another company. It's also quite a good practice to include in an NDA some other restrictions in addition to the non-disclosure, such as non-competition or non-solicitation. We would call that type of agreement a NNN. That's what we usually draft for clients dealing with companies in China. And as you may know, NDAs or NNNs, they're pretty straightforward, relatively standard. And so, the key takeaway on my part would be that they're actually generally too simplistic from a legal point of view. They don't protect so well the company disclosing confidential information. Why? Well, it's because in practice, if after signing the NDA, you actually don't have any commercial cooperation with the other party, the recipient, or the recipient doesn't have any proper consideration, then in many countries, the local courts in case of dispute may deem that, for example, in your NDA, there's a very high penalty clause in case of disclosure. The court might actually consider this high penalty clause as not reasonable and can legally reduce that amount. So as lawyers, in that case, we would need to find maybe some other legal basis to prevent the recipient of using your confidential information or technology. We would use, for example, unfair competition, or we would try to challenge their IP registration made by that recipient. So it's far from ideal. So generally, you know, NDAs, they're just a first step for negotiating, concluding other contractual arrangements, such as distribution agreements or IP license agreements that I'm going to discuss too.
One point to note there is that for an NDA, do your homework before signing the NDA. Don't think that the NDA is going to protect you. Try and make sure that the party you're dealing with is reasonably trustworthy, that you have some knowledge about them, and then enter the NDA. I think that's a good way to look at that. Thanks.
Yes, and thanks, Neil. And in the region, what we can see also often in practice is that our North American clients or European clients, they would feel reassured signing with a Hong Kong company that owns and operates the factory in mainland China. But that Hong Kong company is anti-shell company. So you know, our advice would be to sign the NDA directly with the factory or the companies in mainland China and not their holding company in Hong Kong, or it could be like joint party. So moving on to another type of agreement, distribution agreements, some key elements that you want to have maybe in your toolkit. First of all, you need to make sure that your own IP rights that you're going to grant a license to the distributor, such as trademarks or patents, well, you need to make sure that they're already really duly registered in the jurisdiction where the distributor is going to use them or sell your products. And if you don't directly own these IP rights in that jurisdiction, you need to clarify in the agreement, the distribution agreement, who owns these IP rights. Or you need to confirm that you have a right to sublicense that IP right to the distributor. Another point is that in the distribution agreement, you need to ensure you grant a proper license or right to use your IP with details on the scope of products or services, duration, termination rights, how to deal with the consequences of termination of the license agreement or distribution agreement. And then you may want to consider also imposing several, you know, restrictions on the licensee or the distributor, such as a prohibition to register the brand under its own name, you know, or what we can see also often in practice, for example, in China, the distributor would then register the Chinese translation of your brand under its own trademark in China. You can't imagine the number of times we've seen that in practice, and we always advise our clients then to get back or sometimes purchase back the Chinese trademark. Another obligation you may want to impose on the distributor or licensee is to report to you as a licensor any infringement that they would notice on their own market, infringements you know, by third parties. And then in the contract, you may want to fix which party, either you as a licensor or the distributor, shall file the legal proceedings in that market, conduct the legal proceedings and the strategy, who will pay for the litigation in that market, litigation against, you know, the third party infringing your IP. And then another key item that you need to bear in mind in distribution agreements or when concluding distribution agreements and sharing confidential information, well, is that you need to make sure you keep the confidential information, well, confidential in practice. You need to ask yourself the question, you know, do you need to protect and how should you protect your list of suppliers, your list of clients, the list of pricing, the list of references of spare parts, for example? Do you want, you know, everyone working at your distributor to have full access to all these, or do you consider that, you know, confidential? And in that case, have you at least, or your colleagues have set up, I don't know, like passwords on the Excel files or other electronic files that are going to be sent to the other party? It may sound trivial or like stating the obvious, but you'd be surprised how many times we see commercial or technical teams share confidential information quite carelessly with other parties. And that's an issue, especially in case of dispute or litigation, because then it will be quite difficult to convince courts to recognize there's been a disclosure of confidential information or violation of your trade secret if you know your own company hasn't even made the effort to protect that confidential information when sharing it with other parties. I think, Paul, you wanted to share also some experience of our clients contracting with distributors in different foreign jurisdictions.
Yes, thank you. So one of the things to be aware of when doing overseas distribution, so in addition to your finely crafted agreement that has all the required elements to it, when entering foreign jurisdictions and local jurisdictions, some countries have what are called dealer protection or franchise laws that give certain rights to the local distributor regardless of what your contract says. And these rights, for example, could be the right to compensation on termination of the agreement. It could be protections against termination of the agreement. And of course, the basic theory behind those local statutes is a public policy concern that the local distributor that has built up the local market, you know, should get some benefit for that and some protection for that, for the work that it's put in. So what this highlights is the importance of obtaining local law advice when you're doing overseas distribution. So here, for example, here at Gowling, when I'm acting for a Canadian company that's entering different parts of the world, I can liaise with our office in Guangzhou, in Singapore, France, the UK, and really any other place where there is a local law issue, or you don't necessarily know what the issue is, but you need to run down these points to make sure that you understand, you know, what you're getting yourself into when you begin to sign up distributors in foreign jurisdictions.
Thanks, Paul. So moving on, and as you grow, another type of contract that you may want to consider signing is, and also depending on how much your IP assets are valuable or how your technology is advanced, you may want to consider concluding a robust IP license agreement to better protect your registered IP, or maybe also protect your non-registered IP, such as technical know-how that hasn't been patented. So for IP license agreements, you also need to start with the assumption that in many jurisdictions, like in China, that there may be a high turnover of employees. And so your secrets really have a risk of being lost in practice. So you need to impose contractual obligations on the licensee to put in place a system to ensure that your technology, your trade secrets are duly protected as much as they can be in practice. You need to consider, for example, if it's possible to limit the amount of information that is going to be disclosed. What does your industrial partner really need to know? Don't disclose sensitive information unnecessarily and to anyone working at the licensee. No, you may want to target the persons who really need to have access to all or part of the confidential information related to your technology or IP. Specify what type of confidential information the non-disclosure obligation in the different contracts you have concluded will cover. And that needs to be also imposed down the chain, not only to the company itself, but also you want that company, the licensee, to impose confidentiality obligations to its employees, to its company officers, to its subcontractors, and so on. And then for manufacturing agreements, you may want to also specify who owns the molds and tooling, which are, you know, necessary to manufacture the products using your technology or IP, how the licensee shall return or destroy these molds and tooling after termination of the agreement. And in China, I would say there's a real cultural gap about the ownership of molds and tooling, where foreign clients manufacturing goods in China, they would generally believe that they own the molds and the tooling because the Chinese suppliers made them pay for it. While actually, in the same time, these same Chinese suppliers actually believe that the molds, well, you know, they've been manufactured or paid for to produce a certain amount of goods sold to you. And for example, let's say a mold to produce 10,000 items of your goods and using your IP. After the 10,000 goods have been produced, well, they basically own the mold and the tooling, and they can even use it for other purpose or other clients if they want. So you really need to clarify that in the IP license agreement and in your discussions with the suppliers. And then in IP license agreements, of course, you have the question of royalties, royalty terms. You need to ask yourself the question if your IP is going to be licensed free of charge or for a fixed fee. This is sometimes necessary, you know, for tax reasons or transfer pricing issues. Or maybe the royalties will be a percentage of the revenue generated by the licensee, thanks to your IP. There can also be some royalties or fees paid if you're going to provide some technical trainings regularly to the employees of your licensee and or share some technology improvements that you have developed on your side. So in practice and legally, royalty terms, they are fully negotiable. And this will be based on you know, your company's negotiating power and it's case by case. By the way, our law firm, I understand, is going to hold another webinar soon on this topic of IP valuation. So be sure to follow our mailings and social media if you're interested. Another issue I wanted to point out regarding IP license agreements or even distribution agreements is geographical licensing. Geographic restrictions are generally allowed and they're not necessarily defined by a country. It can very well be a distinctive region in one country. So for example, in China where I sit, you may restrict your licensee to use your IP and sell your goods just in Shanghai and its region, or just in, you know, South China, Guangdong and Hong Kong, because it's different logistics network and industrial tissue, even different consumer habits. The geographic restrictions can be a greater part of the world, like Southeast Asia or whole Asia Pacific. You may want to, in any case, you may want to impose some discipline to your distributors on the geographic restrictions, monitor their sales with regular reporting duties as per the contract. Otherwise, what we've seen for clients is that sometimes their distributors would compete with each other in the world, maybe sometimes too fiercely in the market of the other. That would discourage some distributors or licensees to invest in their jurisdiction and market, because then there would be a gray market of unauthorized resellers that would then ultimately end up reducing, you know, the market prices of your goods using your IP. And then it's another commercial debate on whether you prefer selling, you know, more goods in the short term with different distributors competing with each other very fiercely, or if you want to maintain you know, a robust and clear distribution channel as authorized by you. Paul, I think you wanted to raise another important point about international licensing.
Yes. Yeah, so if you're the licensor and you're doing international licensing of the intellectual property, it's important to understand what the IP laws are of the countries that you're licensing your technology into. For example, what are the IP protections and what are the meets and bounds of them around things for such as protection of inventions, copyright, trademarks, and then also other elements of your intellectual property that may be very valuable, such as know-how, databases, look and feel. You know, these items which may not fit squarely into the traditional categories of copyright, patent, and trademark. You know, what are the protections available in those countries? And therefore, once you understand that, it allows you to include the right terms in your contract to ensure you are getting maximum protection. So in this regard, Vivian will touch on a unique concept of utility model IP in China, and Matilda will talk about the importance of understanding local inventor compensation rules.
Thanks, Paul. It's true that in China, we have one kind of patent. We call it UTT models. It's a category which is often overlooked by our clients from North America or Europe, because they may not have similar IP rights in their home jurisdiction. Basically, a UTT model in China, it's meant to protect incremental invention on products. The legal protection is not as strong as an invention patent, like we say, a real patent, because it's easier to be challenged by third parties. It's valid only for 10 years instead of 20 years for other patents. But UTT models offer a lot of advantages, such as a lower level of scrutiny by the patent office in China for the substantive examination. You can get a UTT model registered much more, you know, quicker and for a lower cost than an invention patent. You have lower requirements legally on the novelty of the invention, lower official fees and annuities, no publication before the grant. So that's also quite useful if you want to keep your invention confidential before you actually get some registration with UTT model or patent. And usually in practice, it would take like 6 to 12 months to obtain a UTT model in China instead of the classic 2 or 3 years for an invention patent. Mathilda, over to you about the inventors.
Yeah, thanks, Vivian. And as Paul mentioned, another country-specific difference to be aware of is inventor compensation or protection rules, which do differ by territory. In Europe, Germany, for example, is well known for having some particularly inventor-friendly requirements for ongoing compensation. And in fact, in a recent deal, I've also come across some protections for academic inventors in Sweden, which are, I would say, very particular, and were certainly new to me before I'd worked on that deal. And of course, it's something that we and our clients have had to work around on that particular project.
Yes, and another area of intellectual property that tends to vary by country is the whole treatment of joint ownership of intellectual property. For example, in the United States, you know, unless there's an agreement to the contrary, and this is where your contract comes into play, but if unless it's covered off in your agreement, each joint owner of a patent can independently license or assign its interest in the joint patent to another party without either any compensation or accounting back to the joint owner or the consent of the joint owner. So what this means is that each co-owner of a joint patent can dilute the IP by signing up licensees. So if you're a joint owner and you're attempting to enforce your IP against an infringer in the marketplace, you may find yourself in the unexpected position that your infringer may go to your joint owner and obtain a license from your joint owner that therefore prevents you from enforcing IP. So once again, unless these topics are covered off in your agreement, if you're dealing with joint ownership in the US, you may find yourself in an unexpected position. In Canada, the situation is different. In Canada, each joint owner of a patent can assign their entire right in the patent without the consent of the other co-owner, but they cannot license their rights to another party without the consent of the co-owner. So what that means is that the IP can't be diluted if you're dealing with a Canadian joint ownership situation. And now Vivian and Matilda will touch on the treatment of joint IP in both China and the UK.
Thanks, Paul. On that question of joint ownership, maybe surprisingly, the situation in China is actually similar to the US, I would say. Chinese patent law authorizes co-owners the right to independently use the patent, license the patent to third parties by way of non-exclusive license. In that event, then any profits resulting from such license to a third party must be shared to the other co-owner. And regarding trademarks, you know, joint ownership of trademarks, Chinese law isn't so clear as you know, for patents. And our recommendation is really to conclude a detailed written contract with the co-owner on the rights and obligations of each party, making sure that this contract is also registered with the relevant authority here in China for trademarks.
Thanks, Vivian. Yes, I would wholeheartedly agree that if you're going down a co-ownership route, then a decent written agreement is an absolute must, wherever in the world you happen to be. But when it comes to jointly owned technology in the UK, another different scenario, the default position here is that each joint proprietor of a patent can use the patented technology itself, but cannot license, assign, or mortgage the patented technology without the consent of the co-owner. Of course, that default can be varied by agreement, as Paul flagged up. But the starting position is actually even more restrictive than the position that Paul outlined in Canada.
I think the key for joint ownership is get it in writing, make sure it's very well documented. The world is changing and we are seeing more and more requests for joint ownership. And so the advice is if you can avoid it, that's great. But if you've got to do it, we can set you up properly to make sure that you're protected in that situation. So now that we've covered off a lot of the terms in these commercial agreements, we thought we'd switch gears a bit and talk about money, getting investment. using your money to buy a company, or possibly having an exit where you sell your company through M&A. So turning it over to Matilda to discuss some of the key aspects in these types of transactions.
Great, thanks, Neil. So I guess the key messages for this section are, number one, to think ahead, and number two, to think like a potential partner or buyer when you when looking to take yourself to market. Whoever they are, your potential buyers, partners, investors will probably want to do due diligence on you. They need to do it from their own governance perspective, but also from an IP perspective. They need the comfort of knowing that your key IP is appropriately protected and that you've got the key measures and agreements in place to be able to exploit it. I would say you can't start thinking about this stuff too early. It's all about getting your house in order ahead of time so that there are no nasty surprises during the diligence process. And as a starter, I would suggest three key areas to focus on. Firstly, registrations, such as patents or trademarks. Look at your current filings. Are there any gaps? Can you bolster any key areas with additional filings? Have you secured rights in the appropriate territories? Are your payments up to date? And one I come across very frequently, are the rights registered in the correct company or individual name? These are all issues that can be addressed, and getting to grips with them ahead of time saves a lot of heartache and money down the tracks when they could trip the whole deal up. Secondly, don't forget your key unregistered IP. Typically, the issue here comes down to, do you own and can you show that you own your key unregistered IP? And to answer that question, look at how that key unregistered IP was developed. For example, did you use contractors? Under English law, IP will usually be owned by the person that creates it, unless they're an employee, in which case it will be owned by their employer. And we do find that in certain sectors, for example, tech or creative services, businesses make a lot of use of contractors. And unless they have an agreement specifically transferring the IP to the commissioning company, then that IP may well still be in the hands of the contractor. That is exactly the sort of issue you need to sort out, ideally before potential buyers, partners, or investors start asking awkward questions. And thirdly, look at your existing IP agreements. So all of the licenses, commercial agreements that Paul and Vivian have talked about earlier in this webinar. Check your key agreement terms. Are they impacted by the proposed transaction? Do you have a change of control clause in there? Are they easily terminable by the other side on short notice? Do they contain broad access rights to affiliate IP, for example, that could act as a poison pill for a potential buyer? Payments again, are you up to date on payments under your key IP agreements? Or will the new transaction itself trigger any payments to your existing partners? In a nutshell, it's important to have an accurate picture of where you stand with your current partners before opening discussions with new ones. And I think Paul has some thoughts on how that equally applies in the context of a licensing deal.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, it's exactly as Matilda says. Many of the issues that Matilda has identified in the context of due diligence for an M&A or an investment also apply in the context of a licensing transaction. Like, for example, if you're the licensee, does your licensor actually own and is the registered owner of all the patents that it's going to purport to license to you? Another scenario is sublicensing. So if your licensor is sublicensing any rights that it holds from other people, it may be important for a licensee to want to review what those head licenses are, you know, verify that they actually convey the necessary rights to your licensor, so your licensor in turn can pass those rights on to you. And then in addition to actually doing the due diligence on the agreements, it may be important to include in your license agreement covenants by your licensor to maintain those head licenses in force and to not terminate them or allow them to expire during the term of your license.
Yeah, absolutely, Paul. Important points. And I guess to sum up on this, when you're looking at scaling through seeking partners or buyers, you need to ensure your IP protection strategy is fit for purpose and that you've done an audit to ensure you know what your rights are. This can sound like a lot of work, but there are people who can help you with this. I mean, our IP professionals around the world help clients with this all the time. And depending on your IP position, you might want to consider having an external IP audit or an IP valuation by way of seller due diligence before any M&A activity. And in fact, as Vivian's already mentioned, IP valuation is itself a specialist topic that we'll be focusing on in the third of this mini series on commercializing IP. So watch out for that. And then finally, in this section, I'm going to hand over to Vivian, who's going to let us know about some particular considerations around M&A activity in China.
Sorry, I'm going to jump in here. We're very short on time, and it's more or less time to go to breakout rooms. So maybe Vivian can raise his points about the China-specific aspects here in the breakout room for the China jurisdiction. Thanks, everyone, and thank you to all of our attendees. We do have breakout rooms that we're able to go into now. And so we're going to set that up. We hope that you've enjoyed our discussion, and we hope that you will come back for our future webinars as we continue this series on commercialization. So in order to go to the breakout rooms, you'll need to click on a link that has been sent to you, or I believe the link may also be in the chat. And so if you click on that link, we'll go to a staging area for the breakout rooms. And thanks again to all our panelists, and also to all of you for attending. We'll see you in the breakout rooms very shortly. Thank you.